Online news site Rappler vows to fight the SEC shutdown order by using all legal means. Joining us now, the CEO of Rappler, Nobel Peace Prize winner Maria Ressa. Maria, good afternoon. Thanks for joining us today.
Thanks for having me, Casey. What a day.
I know, right? I was there in your virtual press conference earlier today, but I want to ask you first, how's the Rappler newsroom doing with this latest development? How is it taking everything in?
I think, you know, it's been several years that we've had to live with this. And when you carry it all the way through, you know, one of the things I've always said is whatever it is we're most afraid of, we have to embrace it. And then we have to figure out what we do. What is the worst case scenario that you have? And then figure out how you change it, how you make it better, how you get over the fear. And that's what we've done. I think, you know, I had said, you know, by now it's been 6 years, and we're just doing our jobs, and we will continue doing our jobs. But we're now able to have plans A through Z. We have lawyers who will hold the line with us, who will make sure that we follow rule of law and that the government follows rule of law.
Real talk now, Maria, is press freedom the collateral damage here, or was this really the goal, to attack it and keep you guys silent?
It's global. You know, it isn't just us. I would say Facebook did. Katie Harbath agreed with me. The Philippines is patient zero. But the Cambridge Analytica whistleblower, Chris Wiley, called us a petri dish, right, where these kinds of tactics of mass manipulation, where in one case, for example, history was changed in front of our eyes. These tactics were tested. And who were the targets? The real targets were the West, America, at that point in 2016. So look, I mean, I called it death by a thousand cuts, not just of press freedom, but of our democracy. And we have to hold the line. ABS has gone through this. You know the kinds of uncertainty we can live through. And I think that it's 2022. We're coming up 2 days before a new administration comes in. And you heard me say this in the press conference. You know, I appeal to the incoming administration to strengthen rule of law, to look at journalists not as the enemies, but as partners, because they will need checks and balances as we move into this extremely difficult world.
Maria, listening to that virtual press con earlier today, and as you just repeated now, you kept on repeating that you will not voluntarily surrender your rights. You will continue to hold the line. But what do you say to the SEC order that basically said it's precisely those rights that were abused, and they're just making things right by virtue of this order, Maria?
So let me not move into the legal thing. What I'll just say is it's a tactic of gaslighting, and it's happened all around the world. Whatever, you know, an illiberal force or whenever rule of law is kind of bent to the point that it's nearly broken, whatever. I mean, these are loopholes. I mean, Carmina, look, I've been a journalist for 36 years, and in less than 2 years, I got 10 arrest warrants. I'm sorry, let me... you know, I had 10 arrest warrants. How is that possible? So I haven't changed, but we continue to do our jobs. And on the SEC, we'll take it. We will appeal. We will take that decision. You heard Francis Lin, who used to be the former president of the Philippine Stock Exchange. There's a difference between shares of stocks and Philippine depository receipts. And, you know, I said three things at the beginning. The first is that we have always maintained that our original agreements, the Philippine depository receipts, were constitutional. I'm pretty independence was the reason why we set up Rappler. There's a clause in our shareholders agreement that gives the power, the money power, to journalists, right? We make the final decisions. I think the second thing is that this is the first time the SEC has acted in this way on press freedom issues against a news organization. And, you know, we cannot, I certainly can't look at that and say it's all right, because it gives up our rights. And then I think finally, the last part of this is that the implications of accepting this, right? Our original statement in January 2018, which is when the attempt to revoke our license happened, just showed you how this is unprecedented. just because it's normalized. I'm shocked ABS-CBN has no franchise. That's shocking, and we all should be shocked. These death by a thousand cuts, they're not small cuts, they're huge gashes. So we need to protect our democracy, otherwise we will lose it.
In a way, Maria, do you think that with this SEC order that it sort of paves a clear way, a clear path forward, and that points all the way up to the Supreme Court?
You've heard our chief counsel, Francis Lim, talk about this. He certainly lined up a legal strategy that will take it up. I guess the reason I announced it this morning, I was given the keynote as the East-West Center Conference. There were more than 300 journalists in the room. And I felt that, you know, the only defense a journalist has is to shine the light. And so this kind of transparency, I hope, will demand better. I mean, you know, this was the reason why, for example, at the Peninsula siege, ABS-CBN did not leave the Peninsula, right? Because when you do leave, the only people who would have been left there would have been the forces of the military. At that point, it was the police. So it's that moment again. There's a lot riding, and I hope that the incoming administration looks at journalists as partners, as checks and balances, the way leadership has in the past, instead of as enemies to be killed. Sorry, let me not use that word. Enemies to be shut down.
Maria, you know, just when you think that everything's going to be, you know, sober and silent and everything's going to get better, there is one case and then another case and then another case and then another case, and things seem to get from worse to worse. But let me ask you, what do you think can turn the tide for you and Rappler from here onwards?
On our end, we demand the light. So everything that is done must withstand public scrutiny. And I gotta say, of the 10 10 arrest warrants I have, they're a little bit, you know, like Kafkaesque. They're a little bit laughable. The cyber libel case I and a former colleague were convicted of was for a story that was written in 2012, so that was whenever, beyond the statute of limitations of libel statute of limitations was changed. It was a story I didn't write, edit, or supervise at a time when the law we supposedly violated didn't even exist, right? There has to be some accountability, otherwise we don't have rule of law. And I believe the Philippines has a potential. There really is a potential for us geopolitically right now, where we can strengthen our democracy despite the economic downturn, despite the war in Ukraine. Journalists are partners in this. And one of the things, I'll say the last thing on this, Carmina, is that, you know, we did this facts first pyramid together. It was the first time globally that there was a whole of society approach where journalists were working together with a second layer, with civil society, with research organizations, and with lawyers in the fourth layer, right? And it worked. I think we need to reimagine the world. And if we do that, this is how we come out of it. Having said that, the quick answer to your question is hold the line. We may lose. We're coming up against a full, you know, tremendous power. But we also have the light. We shine the light on every action point.
Maria Ressa there, CEO of Rappler and also Nobel Peace Prize winner. Thank you so much for joining us today. I know it's you're in Hawaii now, but thank you for taking time out to be with us this afternoon. Thanks again. Take care and you keep safe.